You're watching Big Brother on the couch. It's experiment time now. And on Friday, the housemates were psychoanalysed in the diary room. And the woman who devised this week's mind-bending test is clinical psychologist Cecilia De Felici. Now, so what was this week's experiment and what was it designed to tell us?
Well, what we wanted to do this week was to get all the housemates to tell us a story, but not, just not any old story. We wanted to get them to tell us a story that would reveal something about their internal world, a little bit about how they relate to themselves and also how they relate to the other housemates.
So how did you do it?
Well, what we did was we gave them some cards, and on the cards we had pictures of all the housemates. We gave them another set of cards which had a location, which was from in and around the house, and another set of cards where they had an object from in and around the house. And they had to take one card from each of these sets and make up a story. So with one person, one location, and one object.
Okay, now, obviously, lots of the stories are very interesting. And we've picked as our first example Chanel. And her story was she chose Brian, the storeroom, and a can of cider. So let's have a look at her story.
Once upon a time, there was a very tall young man called Brian. And one day, Brian was in the Big Brother house, dreaming and dreaming and dreaming of cider. Brian was banging and banging and banging and banging on the storeroom door. And then Brian looked up to a green ray of light, meaning that he could go into the storeroom. Ooh. And then Brian went into the storeroom, and on the shelf was his favouritest ever cider. So he ran towards the can of cider, but the cider kept getting further and further and further away until Brian ran so much that he finally reached the can of cider.
Okay, okay. I sort of thought that was quite a funny story until she got in. Brian got into the storeroom and then it got further and further away, and I was thinking, oh, okay, now it's getting kind of deep. What did all that mean?
I think it's very interesting because I think this story is a little bit about Chanel and where she is at the moment. Here we've got Brian, and he's banging on that storeroom door.
And Brian wasn't an obvious choice for her to pick as
well,
a housemate.
I think the reason why she chose Brian is because Brian is a very nice person. He's very warm, he's very caring, he's got a lot of emotional intelligence. These are all things that Chanel values in him, but also in herself.
Right.
And I think this links very nicely with her story, because there's Brian. He's desperate to get this thing he really wants, which is locked away in the storeroom. And he's banging on that door, trying to get in, and there's no way he can get in. Is anyone listening to Brian to try and get in to get this thing he really wants? Now, I think this is a metaphor for Chanel. I think what the storeroom represents is like the treasure chest of winning Big Brother. And the thing, the cider, becomes this thing that she really wants, which is celebrity, fame, success, all of that. But nobody's listening. No one's opening that door for her. And then this beam of light comes down and magically transforms Brian into the storeroom to get at this cider. Now, this beam of light is like, well, it's like a spotlight, isn't it? It's like being in the limelight, getting all the attention. Now, if Chanel can magically get all that attention for herself, she might get a chance of grabbing hold of this thing, this cider, which I think is the success, but it's like she's so close to it and yet it's still so far. And I think this is her story. She's in the Big Brother house now. She's worked really hard to get there. She's come a long way, this girl, from where she started. But is it possible for her to really get hold of this thing and win it?
You wouldn't think that it might be about Ziggy, the sort of unattainable, like she's kind of worried about it or she's trying to reach him or...
I think Ziggy is wrapped up in this a little bit, because Ziggy and Chanel form this celebrity couple. They're a celebrity couple in the house. Now, her relationship with Ziggy is very rocky. They're so on and off, this couple. But I think that they know that
we want them to be together.
Yeah. But I think that they both know that so much is invested in the fact that they're a couple. Mm. Now, if they leave the house as a couple, that's real celeb stuff. That's Victoria and David walking down the street together, which is part of their fantasy. Without that, what has she got? Mm. So I think that's why it feels really unobtainable.
It's like a spiritual thing to her, isn't it? The light coming down.
Exactly, but she's very resourceful and she's very hopeful, because in the end, Brian gets that cider and he gulps it down, and it's like her saying, I might get this thing, get refreshed, and my whole life might change.
Or she might get quite drunk on the cider.
And fall over.
OK, so let's move on to our next one. So we're going to have a look at Charlie, who chose Nikki, the kitchen, and cider again. They're obviously gagging for alcohol,
they
aren't
like
they?
A drink.
Let's
like
have a look.
In comes this 4-foot-tall girl called Nikki. I ask myself, who is this girl? Who is she? She seemed very, very nice. As I say, looks are very deceiving. She loved a can of cider, if I must point it out. And always in the kitchen, she wanted to cook. She wanted to stir and stir the meat till it was so stirred, couldn't get any stirred anymore. Then a guy arrived in her life. Big guy, spiky hair, blue eyes. His name was Liam. Made her very happy. Another girl called Carly got in with her and found her a really nice girl. They become closer. At the beginning, Carly couldn't stand Nikki. So Charlie become, should I say Carly, sorry, become to understand Nikki and they become friends.
Well, that wasn't that thinly veiled, was it, there? Charlie, hey, Carly. And I loved all that stirring and stirring. And she went, meat!
Yes.
What's that about?
Well, I think here we've got Charlie and her conflicts yet again. Mm. She really diminishes Nikki right at the start.
Hello, 4 foot tall.
4 foot tall. And she's saying, look, this girl looks really sweet and innocent and lovely, but underneath she's not. She's mean and sarcastic. And I think, again, we might say that this could be a projection because we know that Charlie looks great on the outside, doesn't she? But inside, sometimes we see parts of Charlie that aren't so nice. But then she goes on to say, when Nikki gets this guy and this cider, suddenly she's a different person. And again, we could say this might be a projection because we know that when Charlie gets a drink and a guy, she's a different person.
God, she needs a guy for affirmation in that house. None of the guys want to be with her.
She really does want a guy. And I think that this is a little bit about her jealousy, but it's also a little bit about her need to have an ally. She hasn't chosen her allies very well.
No.
Shab's evicted. Billy evicted. But what's really interesting about this story is at the end, you notice that she got the Charlie Carly thing muddled up. Now, that's a parapraxis, that's a Freudian slip. So we start to see that she's really talking about herself. Mm. And what's interesting is at the start of the story, she really hates Nikki, but at the end of the story, she likes her.
Yeah.
Now, this tells us a lot about Charlie's emotional development. It's like she's stuck in adolescence. Do you remember when you were an adolescent, you either really loved your mates or you really hated them?
Yeah, and you could do both in one day.
Absolutely.
You could start the day off, and then you come home and go, I love her, so much.
Absolutely. You oscillate between the two. It's like you need your parents and you love your parents, but if they don't do what you want, you hate them. Now, this is a very adolescent way of behaving. She looks like a grown woman, she looks like the real thing, but emotionally, I think she's really stuck at a much earlier stage of development.
Well, I was talking about her today, you know, and we said, you know, she's 21. I mean, I forget that Charlie is that young.
Yeah, she's very young.
Because she's so full of kind of bravado.
And neuropsychology tells us that our brains remain adolescent until we're about 25, so we can carry on having hissy fits until we're 25.
Or my case, 39.
But she is very... I think what we're saying here is that she is emotionally quite undeveloped, and that's why we see so much of this explosion going on. She loves, you know, somebody one moment, she hates the next. Billy, she really hated, and suddenly, best friends, and then he's out.
Sure, we're going to be seeing a lot more of that this week.
A lot more of that.
Thank you very much. Cecilia.